Well, thank you so much for coming.
Where does the First Amendment draw the line? Dozens of Cop City protesters are facing racketeering charges in state court, testing how far prosecutors and courts can go in prosecuting people for protest activity. Prosecutors increasingly are using racketeering statutes in cases that implicate constitutional interests. Have anti-organized crime laws been stretched to the breaking point? Hello everyone and welcome. My name is Samantha Hamilton and I am the Georgia Journalism and Access Project attorney with the First Amendment Clinic at the University of Georgia School of Law.
Good afternoon everyone. I'm Sarah Hunt-Blackwell. I'm the First Amendment Policy Advocate with the ACLU of Georgia.
And we are your co-moderators for today's panel. We are bookending, tag teaming. So 2023 was a big year for RICO in Georgia. I just spoke a little bit about the Cop City RICO indictment, but I think we would be remiss if we didn't talk about two of the other very prominent RICO prosecutions currently pending in Georgia, those being the Young Slime Life or YSL indictment and the Trump indictment. So first, there's the Young Slime Life or YSL indictment, which involves charges against famous Atlanta rapper Young Thug, aka Jeffrey Williams, along with over 25 other individuals. The indictment was filed in 2022, but a lot of action happened in that case in 2023. Then there's the Trump indictment, filed in August 2023 for accusations against former President Donald Trump, Rudy Giuliani, Sidney Powell, and others for their role in attempting to influence Georgia electors in the 2020 presidential election. And last but not least, there's the indictment brought by the Attorney General's office against 61 individuals arising out of alleged protest activity against the Atlanta Public Safety Training Center, known by its opponents as Cop City. That indictment was also filed in August 2023, the same month the Trump indictment was filed. All three cases have been criticized for criminalizing expressive activity protected by the First Amendment. Today we're going to get into what RICO is, what the First Amendment protects, what these three RICO cases have in common, and what these prosecutions and related legislative actions mean for the future of the First Amendment in Georgia. We have some very knowledgeable folks on the panel today who know a lot about this topic, and we're excited to introduce them. To my left here is Lindsay Barron, a criminal defense attorney and former assistant U.S. attorney. Next to her is Elizabeth Taxel, assistant clinical professor and director of the UGA School of Law Criminal Defense Practicum and former public defender. Next to her is Matt Scott, editor of the Atlanta Community Press Collective. Next to Matt is Devin Franklin, Movement Policy Counsel with the Southern Center for Human Rights and a former public defender. And then there's my colleague Sarah at the far end with the ACLU of Georgia. So the First Amendment says that Congress shall make no law abridging the freedom of speech or of the press. What that means is that Congress or any other form of our government may not punish people for their speech when the decision to punish is based on the content of their speech. But the U.S. Supreme Court has held that the Constitution does not erect a per se barrier to the admission of evidence concerning one's beliefs and associations simply because those beliefs and associations are protected by the First Amendment. And reconciling these two ideas can be really complicated, especially with respect to alleged certain crimes. What is RICO?
Okay, I'll take this one. Okay, so let me start. It's
microphone closer.
Is this better?
Yes.
Okay.
So the federal RICO statute was passed first, and it was passed specifically in response. I'm not telling you anything you already know. It was passed in response mainly to mafioso, to the organized crime. New York and Chicago and other places. And the reason for passing that particular, the expansiveness of RICO, is that within organized crime, you had lots of different types of criminal activity going on, fencing goods, prostitution, alcohol, I think Al Capone. But the people at the top were so insulated, they wouldn't necessarily give the orders. They weren't the ones carrying out the conduct. And so for years, there was no way to really get at the people at the top other than to charge them with tax violations, which is how they got Capone. And so Congress thought, we need a way to bring in everyone who's involved in this conduct, even if we could not specifically charge them with the individual crimes, hence the birth of RICO. You define the organization, and so anyone who is a part of that organization or who profits from that organization can be brought in, can be charged, and the penalties are staggering. And after RICO was passed at the federal level, you saw mob boss high up people going from serving a year, year and a half on tax evasion to serving 15, 16, 17, 18, 19 years. Stat max is 20 federal RICO. Georgia's RICO statute was passed in 1980, I think it was, and originally mirrored the federal statute. Don Samuel has this characterization in a chapter he wrote on RICO where he says it mirrors federal RICO, but in the way that a carnival funhouse mirror works, because the Georgia Assembly has so tinkered with it and so broadened it and so expanded it that it is very difficult now, just as a thought experiment, to separate out what is garden variety conspiracy from racketeering. And it makes a huge difference in terms of how you build a case. So the argument as a prosecutor, or for those of you who do civil law, as a plaintiff's attorney for bringing RICO, is that you can overcome a lot of evidentiary hurdles. You get in stuff that otherwise might be 404B. It allows you to protect against severance, because now you can bring all kinds of crimes that are not necessarily connected. And so prosecutors like it for that reason, that it just makes it easy to dump a bunch of garbage into one pot, have one trial, all this prejudicial evidence that otherwise wouldn't come in. But it is, I think, as we're going to talk about now on this panel, just completely out of control in Georgia.
Did anyone else have anything they wanted to say about RICO?
Oh, everyone looked at me, but no, I think that Lindsay gave all the historical precedent that there is to kind of know about it. I guess getting more specifically into the context of racketeering as kind of the foundation of a racketeering charge. You know, the reason for the scheme initially was the fact that the mafia was able to create revenue through a number of businesses, for lack of a better term, that otherwise would not have existed but for their creation. And so kind of like fencing, like they would steal goods and then they would sell them elsewhere. They created a stream of revenue that could not be regulated. When alcohol was prohibited, they would bootleg and create liquor and sell it, create a stream of revenue that did not exist. With drug sales, the same thing, right? The numbers racket, creating a lottery system that was not otherwise within the purview of what functioned in the United States as currently known at that point in time. So the intention was to kind of figure out a way to address these activities that were outside of the scope of the traditional economic streams that existed in America. But as Lindsay so astutely kind of named, in Georgia, it's kind of like, we don't like the activity that you do. We want to figure out a way to wrap up as many people within this concept where they otherwise would not be able to directly impute liability criminally for someone. And so as opposed to having to take on the burden that they say that they so often shoulder happily, they instead seek to find ways to punish and create a narrative to criminalize as opposed to actually maintaining a case on the evidence at hand, so.
And I'll just add, I think it's useful to keep in mind that Georgia already has conspiracy as a substantive offense. Georgia already allows prosecutors to prosecute individuals as a party to a crime. So within the Georgia's criminal code, we already have these ways that we can prosecute conspiracy activity. I think what we see is really the weaponization of the racketeering statute because of all of these evidentiary and procedural advantages that it provides to the prosecution while enabling them to just, like Devin said, just swoop in a very large amount of individuals with the most capacious theory of liability available under Georgia law.
All right, now let's get into the three cases pending in Georgia criminal courts. We'll begin with the YSL case, which was the first of the three cases that we're discussing to be indicted. The indictment identifies the YSL enterprise as a group of almost 30 people who, quote, illegally obtain money and property through a pattern of racketeering. The indictment describes the objectives of the conspiracy being, quote, preserving, protecting, and enhancing the reputation, power, and territory of the enterprise through acts of racketeering activity, including murder, assault, and threats of violence, as well as, and this is the key, what we kind of want to dive into here, the posting of messages, images, videos, and songs demonstrating allegiance to the enterprise and a willingness to engage in violence on its behalf. The indictment lists 182 overt acts committed in furtherance of the conspiracy, and a lot of the overt acts are acts of expression, like photos on social media of folks wearing YSL colors or flashing a hand sign. A number of the acts are also postings of lyrics from Young Thug and music videos associated with Young Thug's music as well. Many of the lyrics in the identified in the indictment don't seem to really be traceable to any particular real life event that happened. Instead, they appear to be tropes and themes that are common to the hip hop genre. Some of the lyrics are up on the screen right now. I will let you all read them silently to yourselves. but we see here, and it's been written and discussed in a book called Rap on Trial by UGA School of Law professor Andrea Dennis and Eric Wilson, that the entire genre of hip hop involves these lyrics that really feature just hyperbole, braggadocio, violence, and displays of toughness. But this doesn't necessarily mean that these lyrics are representing anything that has happened in real life. The YSL indictment was filed in 2022, and Judge Glanville ruled in November 2023 that the rap lyrics listed in the indictment were admissible in Young Thug's trial. So this is a question for all of our panelists. What are your thoughts on the prosecution's use of rap lyrics, music videos, and social media photos to prove that Young Thug and other members of YSL were committing RICO?
I'll take the first shot at it. I think the formal Latin term for it is trash. I think that it's a really dangerous line. It's a slippery slope. I'm aware of very, very few cases where there is something that could tangibly be acknowledged as an actual admission to a crime that someone has rapped about, and therefore speaking about it in a song is akin to an actual type of confession. Like, it was a really small rapper, I've heard of this kind of thing before, right? But the way that we see that rap lyrics are currently being used, quite frankly, seems to be more of an attack on culture. It seems to be something that permeates the concepts of legal jurisprudence and instead seeks to, kind of like the concept that we're going to kind of be visiting in a lot of these cases, seeks to find ways to criminalize behavior that doesn't necessarily fit into what is deemed to be acceptable or decent within the United States of America. And so some of these lyrics can be seen as offensive to people. Some people will see that you know, it promotes violence allegedly or things of that nature. And it's not equitable, I think, is the larger point I'm trying to make.
I want to point out one thing, though, because I think that there are kind of two issues here. And I think that there is a tiny sliver of an argument to be made for admissibility in limited circumstances. So one of the things that the state has to prove as an element of, you know, whatever section of RICO it's charging, they have to prove the existence of an enterprise and the defendant's membership or participation in that enterprise. And so for those of you who aren't lawyers, there's a rule of evidence that says that a party's, it's rule 801D2, a party's own statements are admissible at trial against them in order to prove some fact that is in dispute. And so there, I believe there really could be a limited purpose. If you've got a social media post where someone is saying, you know, 4PF for life or YSL for life, I mean, if they establish first that that's a game, and you are somehow admitting to your membership in that gang, that's a limited way in which I think that could arguably come in, okay? It is a different thing, and this is what is different about what we see now. Oh, and let me say too, lyrics have been used in prosecutions for years. I mean, go back to, I think it's 2005, Snoop Dogg was prosecuted. His lyrics came in at that trial, so this is not new. What is new is this different focus on the lyrics themselves, not just being admissions and admissible for that limited purpose that I was talking about, but themselves being criminal acts, overt acts of racketeering. So a lyric being criminal conduct, and that's what's new. And that to me, I think we have to distinguish when we talk about lyrics, it's not just a monolith. The question is, how is it being used? How is it being charged? Because that influences the analysis of whether we are crossing over from limited admissibility to show membership in an enterprise, or are we saying that the speech itself is criminal? And that's what we see right now in Fulton County.
There's this central premise in criminal law that the state is supposed to prove guilt beyond a reasonable doubt through actual evidence that the person engaged in the specific acts that constitute a crime. And so when you have conspiracy prosecutions, the state no longer has to prove that a specific person did these specific things beyond a reasonable doubt in order to receive the conviction. And one of the evidentiary rules is that the prosecution is not supposed to use character evidence, who this person is as a person, to prove criminal conduct. They're supposed to prove guilt through actual evidence. And so by including association, membership as an element of RICO, it necessarily allows the prosecution to bring in association, which is also protected under the First Amendment. And I think the YSL indictment takes it even a step further, because they're using and including the posts, the portions of the lyric in the indictment itself before there's even been a ruling on the admissibility. And so you have everybody who's following this case reading all of these alleged overt acts. They're seeing the posts, they're forming conclusions on them. They're reading the lyrics, they're forming conclusions about that before there's even been an evidentiary ruling on its admissibility. And so I think it really is just a complete abomination of like the basic tenets of criminal law that suddenly you are allowed to use somebody's artistic expression to prove criminal activity, and that you can guarantee its relevance by including it in the indictment itself.
I would say, as the only person up here who's not a lawyer, I don't think about it in terms of the law, but in terms of how I think we need to be explaining it. And looking at this indictment, a full third of the indictment is made up of social media posts or lyrics. A third have no crime to them at all. And when we're thinking about this trial, we're thinking about the big nature of it and the braggadocious nature of it. That's the thing that I don't think is being communicated well enough, is how much of the state's case is made up of not crimes.
Thank you. Those are all great points, and I think they also kind of lend themselves to a now famous quote from Fannie Willis saying, "No, if you're going to admit to your crimes over a beat, I'm going to come and get you for that." So even before the prosecution has even started, you know, there's this assertion that the rap lyrics are used to corroborate actual crimes that have happened without that the due process even having started. Now, thank you all for this discussion on YSL. We'll now move into discussion about the Trump indictment. So it has 41 counts and allegedly 161 overt acts. It describes the manner and methods of the enterprise as making false statements for solicitation of high-ranking officials, including state and DOJ officials and the Vice President of the United States, creating and distributing false Electoral College documents, unlawful breach of election equipment in Georgia, and harassment and intimidation of Fulton County election worker Ruby Freeman, among others. Again, part of the indictment includes social media posts, specifically tweets that were posted to Donald Trump's Twitter account that are used in conjunction with this indictment. So again, in an effort to not repeat the statements of someone else, I will allow y'all to read the statements on the screens here. Trump's lawyer argued that his speech amounts to core political speech, which receives the highest amount of protection under the First Amendment. He also said that the prosecution seeks to use statutes to charge President Trump that were never intended to criminalize core political speech. So what do you all think about the political speech at issue in the Trump case? We said that in the YSL case, you know, the music videos and the rap lyrics aren't necessarily linked to any particular crime or have any particular effect, and they're just acts of expression. So what can we say the same thing about former President Trump's tweets?
Sorry, I had a client in this case, so I have to be careful. My client pled early, so I'm no longer in this case. But one thing that I think that is important to note is that the First Amendment is a sword, it is a shield, and we have to be clear about when it is one or the other. And I'm trying to speak very generally on purpose. I think it is important to think about whether the First Amendment protects your right to propagate things that you know are not true and that you have been told over and over again are not true in order to manipulate an outcome. I think that is different than First Amendment protected speech. And I think that depending on how that trial comes out, I mean, you obviously are going to argue this is protected political speech. And for some people and for some defendants, it may be. But for other defendants, there may be proof that they knew that the things that they were saying were not true, but they were saying them anyway for reasons that had nothing to do with political expression and something to do with a different motive. And so I think I'm being very obtuse, but I hope that you understand what I'm trying to get at, that I think the prosecution, in order to be successful in this case, is gonna have to show that difference. That political speech does not mean that you get to perpetrate things that you know to be untrue, claim it's speech, because your actual agenda is something different than that.
And I'll interject here just for clarification purposes, since Lindsay can't clarify. What we're talking about here is allegations and accusations that the 2020 presidential election was stolen from Donald Trump. So
I think that's what it's, I mean, this is in every criminal trial, it's going to be mens rea. If the state can prove that you knew that what's in your head is that you knew that what you were saying was untrue and that your intent in saying it was not to express yourself, but to achieve some other purpose, then arguably that's criminal. If they can't prove that mens rea, then maybe it is just political speech. And so I think that is really what that trial is going to come down to.
It's perhaps a bit unnecessary to say in a room full of lawyers, but I think it goes back to the very simple concept that we've all heard and learned in law school, that you can't yell fire in a crowded theater. That is not protected speech. Because the intent is to just cause chaos, and there's no need for that type of thing to be put into the atmosphere. But I will just tie this back into the concept of the RICO, also venture into whether the RICO was necessary to address those things that are the focus of the alleged criminality in this particular indictment. For the former president himself, I haven't followed the case super closely, so please correct me if I'm wrong about any of my assertions. There was a phone call that everyone heard that a lot of legal analysts felt was very on point to establish certain elements of a particular substantive crime, right? To the extent that RICO is now being used to allow for a lot of people who are associated in this effort around trying to establish that the election was stolen, it has complicated matters, unfortunately for some people at this point in time, in a way that has conflated what the issue actually is. And so we're now dealing with a lot of questions that are irrelevant to the assessment about whether a crime was needed, because again, RICO was being used to create a larger narrative to try to wrap up a lot more people who may or may not have done criminal things, but using someone else's assertions for creating this larger narrative.
I think that point really cannot be overstated, because Fulton County, at least in the last few years, seems not to use a sniper. They seem to use bazookas in the way that they attack a lot of crimes. And I don't mean that as a normative statement, but maybe I do. But I think the issue is that in this case, if you've read that indictment, The enterprise that is described is the entire campaign and even people who aren't part of the campaign. So some of the overt acts that are alleged to have occurred in Michigan, Wisconsin, Arizona, Pennsylvania, South Carolina. It's everything. Basically, anybody who did anything as part of that effort could have been indicted in Fulton County. And that's dangerous, as Devin said, because then, you know, when it is everything, it is nothing, really. And so I think there is a way to bring it in a targeted sniper-like way. That's just not the choice that was made.
What I'm hearing some folks say is that the purpose in, or the purpose behind the speech is really important. It sounds like, Lindsay, you're characterizing Trump's tweets as, you know, maybe not necessarily pure expression, but like very calculated.
I think that's what it's going to come down to, is what did he know and what did he intend? And that separates this from no other criminal case. It's all going to be the mens rea of what was his intent with those tweets.
Right. And that feels different to me, at least, than what folks who post on social media flashing hand signs, you know, saying young slime life, you know, what their purpose is in, you know, publishing on social media. Can you all speak to that comparison? Like, why do any of us post anything on social media?
I don't post it.
I mean, anybody else feel free to jump in, but again, it goes so far into like the personal intentions of people that are not always discernible. You could, as a public figure of any stature, there is always some, at a minimum, negligible benefit to just being seen, right? for young slime, like the concept of being a slime, right, has gone beyond what could have once perhaps been seen as affiliation with the street gang, and it's just common nomenclature at this point in time for my guy. Like, what's up, slime? What's up, my guy? Like, you see LeBron James, I think they actually did this in trial a few days ago, LeBron James doing the wipe your nose sign, right? Which, you know, if you talk to a gang investigator in Atlanta, they're gonna say that to wipe someone's nose means to kill someone. If you ask someone else who is like not from Atlanta and only knows of the concept of slime from music, they will tell you that it's just a phrase that, you know, means to take care of business. You know, like, and so I think just promoting a brand is always profitable in any estimation. And in a country that is built foundationally on the concepts of capitalism, to punish people for promoting a brand, it's concerning.
And finally, last but not least, we have the Cop City indictment, which charges a staggering 61 people with RICO for protest activity related to the Defend the Atlanta Forest movement. Matt, you've been covering the Defend the Atlanta Forest movement closely over the last couple years. What is this movement?
Yeah, so the Defend the Atlanta Forest movement, or the Stop Cop City movement, I guess we could go back to 1911 when the city bought this land, but we'll start in 2017. There were two competing plans that were developed. The city of Atlanta adopted a plan into its charter to enshrine a particular piece of land outside of the city proper, an unincorporated CAF, as public parkland. At the same time, an organization known as the Atlanta Police Foundation began to develop a plan to build a new public safety training center for police, fire, and the Department of Corrections on that same land. So the city adopted this into its charter, it becomes the expectation. And then, of course, the George Floyd protests happen, and then we see a decrease in the number of police officers in Atlanta and this focus on morale. And so then-Mayor Keisha Lance Bottoms introduces a plan in the AJC talking about this public safety training center and how it's going to boost morale and improve retention. And it is designated to go in that plot of land in unincorporated DeKalb County. So almost immediately, groups rise up in opposition. Namely, there's a group called that was called Defund APD, Refund Communities, Community Movement Builders, and they quickly named this Cop City, named for inside. There's a mock city or a mock village. It's changed names, to more PR-friendly terms over the last 2 years, but. They rise up in opposition, and they get up this electoral campaign to try to convince city council to vote it down. City council listens to something like, I believe, 17 hours of public comment, eventually votes it through, thinking that that would be the end of it. Another group begins what they call a forest occupation. So for a year, from December of 2021 until January of 2023, they more or less continuously occupied the land that this training center was supposed to go on. That ended on January 18th, it was the second of two police raids on those encampments where one individual, police allege, got into a shootout with the Georgia State Patrol SWAT team. That SWAT team shot and killed that protester, and then that was the end of the encampment. There was a week of action thrown to sort of reinvigorate the movement in March 2023. That led to a group of people splitting off, torching construction equipment on the land, and then police raiding a nearby music festival that was being held, and charging 23 more people with domestic terrorism, including a legal observer. Then we had a referendum campaign where over 100,000 people from the city of Atlanta signed a petition to add a referendum question to basically overturn the lease of this property. The city council had every opportunity to just continue to put forward this proposal. There was another series of public comments in June of 2023. Initially, the facility was said to cost taxpayers $30 million. It was my reporting that found out that all along they had known it was going to cost more than double that, $60 million. And of course, now the price tag of the facility has raised another $20 million, though allegedly that will not go to taxpayers.
Thank you, that was a really efficient recap. I'm really impressed. Okay, so now there's an indictment. Lizzie, I'll start with you. What's in the indictment? What does it say?
It says a lot of things. I mean, I think before we get to the indictment, I think it is important and interesting to focus on the fact that originally you had 40 plus people who were charged with domestic terrorism in DeKalb County because the location of the facility is in DeKalb County. And the domestic terrorism statute that took some iterations in order to include damage to critical infrastructure to basically encapsulate the property damage that the protesters are accused of committing. Sherry Boston very publicly announced her decision to not participate in those prosecutions. And then you have 6 months later, the Attorney General chooses to file this, to call it sweeping is an underestimate. The sweeping indictment, 110-page indictment in Fulton County charging 61 people with racketeering. The indictment attempts to tell a number of different stories. It attempts to tell the story of when the movement started. Interestingly enough, the Defend the Atlanta Forest movement started before the plans to construct this facility had even begun. And so according to the Attorney General, the Defend the Atlanta Forest movement began during the racial justice protests that came out of the killing of George Floyd. The indictment then attempts to explain what is anarchy, what is collectivism, what is solidarity. And it is replete with descriptions of political thought. And so what's so, I think, incredible about this particular indictment is the criminal conspiracy that the Attorney General has defined in their indictment is inextricably intertwined with political thought. And then the indictment is the protesters, they are indicted under a particular subsection of the racketeering statute, which is conspiracy to commit RICO. So again, it is the widest net that the Attorney General could have possibly used to try to prosecute 61 individuals. And then they list hundreds of alleged overt acts in their attempts to prove the participation of these 61 people in furtherance of the conspiracy. And out of those overt acts, we have very few that actually describe the violence and property destruction that the state of Georgia claims is the justification for this prosecution. So there were acts of vandalism, there were acts of arson, and there are a small number of individuals, five, who were charged specifically with domestic terrorism and attempted arson. But then you have a large number of people who are accused of committing these overt acts for things like distributing flyers that contain publicly available information.
Giving legal advice. Lawyers are in this indictment.
A legal observer is in the indictment. things like getting reimbursed for camping supplies in order for individuals to exercise their purported constitutional right to protest, to engage in an act of civil disobedience. And by the way, the racketeering statute, it says in its definition section that this statute is not designed to criminalize protected activity, yet there are individuals who are accused of basically reimbursing protesters for the supplies needed to camp out in the forest, which worst case scenario, that's a criminal trespass, that's a misdemeanor. The racketeering statute as of today, that might change in a couple of weeks, excludes civil acts of disobedience and misdemeanor conduct as a specific act that constitutes racketeering activity. So the indictment is really 110 pages of activity that largely includes what we think of as First Amendment protected activity, and it claims that a group that is held together by a political belief is in fact the criminal enterprise. It's an incredible read. I encourage everybody to spend some time with it.
I think one thing that it's worth kind of stepping back philosophically and thinking about where we are in RICO, as I think best personified by that particular indictment. Remember that the point of this legislation, going back to the 60s, was to target organizations, to target enterprises, and the ways that they would use criminal activity to increase their scope, increase their footprint, increase their financial bank, right? That's the goal, is to go after the organization. What it has become, particularly here in Georgia, which we have, Georgia has the most liberal application of state RICO than, I mean, there are other states that are as liberal. By liberal, I mean broad and basically without parameters. Ours is the most expansive. And so where we are now is that where it was designed to target organizations that existing tools of prosecution could not reach, it has become instead a tool of the prosecution to bring cases that are A, more convenient because you overcome those severance and those 404B issues. Particularly, there's a nasty little rule here in Georgia, 244418, that ties into this and basically allows you to bring in any prior criminal conduct of any gang member for any reason you want to at all outside of 404B. You still got to pass 403 balancing, but it's nasty. And so what this allows a prosecutor to do is basically target not just the criminal activity, but the ideas. All of these cases could have been brought individually in the jurisdictions in which those crimes occurred. You could charge the vandalism, and I don't think anybody here would disagree that if you set a building on fire, that's a crime, right? So prosecute that crime. But that's not gonna make news. It's not gonna make news to charge an individual gang member for one assault or one drug sale. It makes news when you get particularly someone famous or when you can charge an ideology and a movement because you don't like what they're doing because they're being pests. And so that, I think, is what has happened, is that we have used this statute that had a very specific and discreet purpose, and we have weaponized it into a way to target not just lyrics, but entire ideologies that we find uncomfortable and that we otherwise don't have the means to tackle through the criminal process.
It's tough for me to sometimes talk about this because there are so many places that you can start and so many parts of this that you can critique and criticize. I think one of the things that particularly the Cop City RICO case brings to mind to me, and it goes towards the overexpansiveness of Georgia's liberal use of its RICO statute, is that we do not have a legal system, a court system that is built to handle the number of cases that are brought in this way. Because, you know, in a 60-month co-defendant indictment, one person gets a public defender. The second person gets a conflict defender. Every other person gets what we affectionately call C3 defenders, private attorneys who accept public cases. And in the state of Georgia, the infrastructure for C3 appointments is effectively nil. And it does not escape me that part of the intent in charging the case in that way was the anticipation that a number of those persons who would have been arrested, you know, but for efforts from the private bar and nonprofits, would have been without counsel for months on end. Like, without this co-defendant case, there were at one point in time at least 200 people with C3 cases in the state of Georgia who had been without representation, some of them for periods of time that were approaching or over 2 years. And so we're dealing with the weaponization of a statute that fundamentally denies accused persons of their Fifth Amendment due process rights and their Sixth Amendment rights to counsel. And I can't escape the myriad of harms that come from the state being able to effectively punish people because they don't have access to representation, or potentially didn't have access to representation, just because they have the ability and the authority to say that because you sat in a tree in a forest, that there's an overt act in connection with furthering some conspiracy. or because you passed out literature or spoke about something against the state, or because you attended a concert that was intended to rally support for a cause, that the state could effectively snatch your life and liberty away before you have a chance to effectively fight anything. It's not beyond my scope that at pretty much every significant stage in the Cop City Rico, Reign of the Force when Torta Gita was murdered, the Week of Action when a number of people were arrested, the announcement of the indictment, that at every juncture of this case, we have seen coordination from elected officials, the governor, the AG, who have press releases and graphics that like come out hours after the raid and things have occurred, which only seem to underline and embolden the fact that this is not a prosecution intended to actually remedy any crime. It is a prosecution that is intended to criminalize ideology and participation in counter-narratives that certain state actors seem to feel is harmful. Especially, again, when you begin to understand kind of how small the Defend the Force movement was at one point in time, to another point in time where over 100,000 signatures were collected in support of a referendum to vote on whether the facility should be funded. You know, I think when you begin to see and understand that opposition parties understand that they're losing a larger narrative because the objective facts don't support the need for the things that they say from a state perspective, that they're just like, we're gonna find ways to get rid of you. Lindsay alluded to it earlier. There currently was action in the General Assembly. I believe that bill is largely killed at this point in time. But there are efforts to explicitly criminalize or include as racketeering acts, explicitly criminal trespass and loitering, littering, and passing out flyers as specific racketeering acts that are listed in the statute in Georgia. So effectively what they're saying is that there are gaps in the current indictment and they're now seeking to kind of proactively address that in anticipation of using it in the future. And so I think that the political motivations of those who see themselves as counter to movement just kind of provides more context and texture to why the law is what it is and why it is used the way that it tends to be used.
And Devin, you mentioned press releases and press conferences organized by the state. The indictment, the background of the indictment, brings up press conferences thrown by organizers and activists. They say the Defend the Atlanta Forest holds press conferences to control the story and promote their own narrative. Elsewhere it says Defend the Atlanta Forest publishes their own documents and conducts their own press actions instead of allowing the media to report the story. And so it's, you know, the state apparently is allowed to engage with journalists, but this, and I will say with the defendant, the Atlanta Forest, they have built what is, I would consider, a fairly sophisticated media connection. They are fairly quick to respond to media requests. Some of my journalist partners, I know Nick Valencia, have reached out to them, and they respond fairly quickly, and that is now being targeted, your ability to speak for yourself to the press.
I think that there maybe was a missed opportunity here politically, and maybe the opportunity's not lost, but before I went to law school, I was a lobbyist, and so I think about coalition building and how you can bring together unusual groups of people who have a common purpose who wouldn't normally go along. So from a criminal justice perspective, those of us who are crazy criminal defense attorneys, we rarely have any impact, any voice. PACGA, the Prosecuting Attorneys Council of Georgia, has tremendous influence. However, we are in this unusual time period because of the prosecution against Trump and many members of the, not just nationally, but here in Georgia, political members, former chair of the Georgia Republican Party, other very powerful people on the right, who are also very angry about the way in which the RICO statute was used. And I feel like that's an opportunity for, you know, the people on the far right and crazy criminal defense attorneys on the far left to come together and form a strange bedfellows coalition to maybe finally change this law. And, you know, I'm not involved in politics anymore, but my gosh, I wish somebody would put that coalition together.
because we can blame prosecutors all day long and they're going too far, but the truth is the law is written so broadly that it allows them to do exactly what they're doing. And so if we want to change the reality, we have to change that law. And I feel like there's an opportunity here to bring together this strange bedfellows coalition if someone who's not me would just put it together.
Unfortunately, that doesn't look to be the direction.
Yeah, we're going the opposite direction.
You know, the revisions, and so it's Senate Bill 359. It is currently in rewrite. I think people assume that because it wasn't re-presented yesterday, it's going to get tacked on to another bill, but it is explicit in its intention to rewrite the racketeering statute in order to directly prosecute protest-related activity as racketeering, presumably in recognition of the problems with the Attorney General's current indictment. I mean, there's hundreds of pages of demurs and First Amendment challenges that are pending in Judge Adams' court to challenge the legality of the substance of the indictment itself, and also to assert First Amendment defenses to the prosecution. And so the response from the legislator is, well, we'll just rewrite the statute and then we won't have these vagueness and overbreadth and First Amendment problems. I want to add one more thing that I think beyond just the weaponization of the RICO statute that is criminalizing First Amendment conduct is just the impact of prosecution itself. I mean, I think that one of the intents of this sweeping racketeering indictment was literally to shut down the movement. You know, every time somebody is arrested and they get conditions of their bond, that individual who otherwise was protesting at the construction site is now no longer allowed to return to that location. They're no longer allowed to communicate with other members of Defend the Atlanta Forest. They're not allowed to participate on social media. Rather hypocritically, many bond conditions require the protesters to not come back to the state of Georgia unless they had court, which is a bit counterintuitive to the purpose of bond, which is supposed to be a mechanism to ensure that people come to court. Instead, the prosecutors were rather explicit that we want y'all to leave. We don't want you to stay here and protest, and so we're going to use the criminal process. So there's just like these multiple layers of oppression that are occurring through this criminal prosecution. The use of racketeering is to, you know, swoop in a large number of individuals, make the case very difficult to defend itself, but also to literally just shut down the movement itself.
So we've got about 13 minutes left on this panel. Before we open it up to questions, I just wanna take it to the panelists. Is there anything you haven't already told us that you feel is important we know, especially in looking at all three cases together?
I think one thing that surprises people about Georgia RICO that is important to know, and where it's different from federal RICO, I mean, it's different in some key ways, but to me, I think this is the most important one. There's no continuity requirement in Georgia under RICO. And so what I mean by that is that when we traditionally, again, going back to the purpose of RICO, is to target organizations that are going to continue into the future, and the whole purpose of the racketeering activity is to strengthen the scope and the bank of the enterprise. In Georgia, you could theoretically have a racketeering enterprise that existed for an hour. It doesn't have to have existed in the past. It doesn't have to have a purpose of existing into the future. You don't even have to, in Georgia, you don't even have to prove that you yourself are a member of the or a member of the enterprise. If you use that enterprise's funds for any purpose, you could technically be charged under the Georgia RICO statute. So it is, the definition, the scope, the expansiveness, the continuity of the enterprise is fleeting. And that's part of what makes it so broad. And so when we talk about criminal enterprises, I mean, my first exposure to this was about 10 years ago. Meredith Kincaid and I worked with Rick Dean over at Jones Day, representing the former superintendent of Atlanta Public Schools during that whole brouhaha. And I mean, the Atlanta Public Schools was alleged to have been a criminal enterprise. And so it's not just gangs, it's not just evil conspiracies that lurk in the corner at night. It can be lawful organizations, it can be no organization. It can be an association of fact. People who don't even know each other come together for an hour to protest and two of them commit crimes, everybody's now participated in a Georgia criminal enterprise. That's terrifying.
I will segue that into another piece of legislation that is actually awaiting the governor's signature right now, SB 63, which is a criminalization of bail funds. So there was a bail fund that was raided and organizers of that bail fund were charged. A bail fund specifically related to posting bail for Stop Cop City protesters. So now with, again, there are some gaps there, and we're seeing that in this bill, SB 63, that bill expands bail-restricted offenses, including RICO, domestic terrorism, and other protest activity and civil disobedience. But it also limits the number of times that an individual or an organization can contribute a cash bond to anyone. And it limits that to 3 times per year. So again, we're seeing trends here where there are gaps in these indictments and in these prosecutions, and our legislature is coming through and trying to fill those gaps. Again, that is awaiting the governor's signature, and we're hoping that he will not sign it.
I can add one thing about SB 63, which, again, I think everything that we talk about or consider should always be considered in context. So at the very same time that the General Assembly has passed both chambers and we're waiting the signature of this bill, there is also a special commission that is looking into the harms that have been created by overcrowding, particularly in the Fulton County Jail. And for those of you who are not familiar, two things that have been particular interest in terms of what has led to the overcrowding at Fulton County Jail have been slow indictment processes and particularly onerous bond amounts that indigent persons cannot make, and therefore they're trapped in jail because they can't buy their freedom. So at this very same time that this body at the assembly is trying to figure out ways to avoid overcrowding, which last year led to 10 deaths in Fulton County Jail alone, 5 in the month of August alone, they are also promoting legislation that will make it more nearly impossible for many people to get out in any kind of practical time, because you are requiring that cash bail be provided, and then you're limiting who can pay cash bail. And so I think it again kind of goes to, it gives us a peek in the mind of the intentions and the lengths and extents to which state actors will go to punish and criminalize those with whom they disagree.
Yes. I think I see Sarah Brewerton-Palmer with the mic.
Hello. I wanted to talk about the bail conditions that you mentioned, Elizabeth, and I was wondering if anybody has thought about or ever might pursue a First Amendment challenge to those, because they are prior restraints, effectively, right? I mean, obviously, people lose a little bit of rights in the criminal process, but nobody's been convicted yet. I've heard Donald Trump has raised some First Amendment challenges to the restrictions being placed on him in the D.C. criminal case with respect to his speech during the campaign, and perhaps he's a uniquely situated criminal defendant who actually would raise that kind of a challenge, and I know there are incentives against fighting pre-trial bail conditions, but I was wondering y'all's thoughts on the viability of an argument, and practically speaking, is it even something that a criminal defendant would do?
I think this is with respect to specific bonds. the process of criminal prosecution infringes on more than just First Amendment rights. We can dictate, whether or not you're allowed to see your children, whether or not you're allowed to return to your home. In this particular case, we have these specific First Amendment protected activities that are explicitly included as bond conditions. Theoretically, yes, any one of the defendants could file a motion to modify bond and raise as a ground for modification that it is infringing on their First Amendment rights. Now, the standard that the courts are supposed to apply, there are public policy, safety reasons why conditions of bond may be put in place. And so what the court is supposed to determine is whether or not it's the least restrictive way to kind of achieve the broader goal of ensuring the safety of the community, ensuring that there's not witness tampering, ensuring that people return to court. So First Amendment wouldn't be a complete bar, but I think that because an infringement on First Amendment activity is supposed to give great, you know, deference to, I think the state would have a slightly harder time showing that it's not the least restrictive way to ensure that there's not witness tampering, for example. To my knowledge, I know that there are a number of people who are interested in making that challenge. Quite frankly, the size of the prosecution, the expense of litigation, I think it's making people very difficult to address bond conditions in an unindicted case in DeKalb County when they are facing this massive RICO prosecution in Fulton County. So it is also a kind of a resource thing, but it is my understanding that it weighs heavily on many individuals' minds because they are prohibited from communicating with their friends. So it is something that should be raised, but I don't believe it's been raised yet.
Any other questions? I see a hand.
I'm gonna go ahead and ask one while we're waiting. Since this is a media law now, could anybody talk for a minute about what the First Amendment and what the courts have had to say about the protection that is afforded to journalists when they are covering civil disobedience, covering police activity, what protections apply, and where are those lines drawn?
I'm definitely not the expert.
I'm not the expert on media law. I can tell you what it's like covering this. I mean, a picture of me getting tear gas went viral a few months ago in November. What we have seen from not only ABD, but also the Fulton County Sheriff's Office is threats to arrest journalists attempting to cover this. There's what I've seen, I've witnessed, I should say, is a view that any journalist covering this is just a member of the Stop Cop City movement. Anyone who would show up to these things is a member of the Stop Cop City movement, and they are treated as if they are a protester. There's no sort of distinction that I've seen from particularly ABD in who can be somewhere between a protester and a journalist.
To add to that too, as was mentioned earlier in during this panel, we also see this same type of threat happening with legal observers. There was a legal observer who was arrested in the Stop Cop City arrest. And so we're having to look closely and make sure that there are protections afforded to legal observers, media, journalists as well in the coverage and protection, First Amendment protection of the people who are actually involved with the movement. I'll also add too that there are a few bills in the legislature currently where we had to specifically advocate for exemptions for media and journalists. This is something that we're trying to stay on top of and make sure that our media outlets aren't criminalized for doing their jobs and reporting under the First Amendment right.
So I have to play the devil's
advocate.
So I have to play the devil's advocate again. Why are the district attorneys doing this? Right? Aren't they trying to meet the needs of their communities to cut down on perceptions of crime, on violence in the communities? What is the reason behind their decisions to pursue this strategy, and how is that best addressed?
I'll take, I'm the former prosecutor up here, and I think I was put on this panel to give the prosecutor perspective. So I apologize if I have failed in that role, but so I will pinch it here. So 90% of my practice is federal criminal defense, and I do a good bit of RICO, and I've had three RICO. I have one right now, sex, money, murder. I've had NITRE, I've had 532 PIRUs. When the feds take a case RICO, first of all, the thing you need to know about the Justice Department is that to be able to even bring a RICO prosecution, you have to go through multiple layers of review. It goes all the way up to the Assistant Attorney General in charge of the criminal division and ultimately the Deputy Attorney General has to sign off on it, because it is such a powerful weapon and it's so resource intensive that they want to make sure that it is brought in cases where it is truly needed. And so when you see a federal RICO case, it is usually going to be in what we would all consider to be a traditional gang, where there's murder, there's coordination, there's hierarchy, there is infrastructure, there's a beat in, beat out process, initiation, there are rules, there's retaliation, there's punishment. Things that we think about when we think about organized crime, that the key letter in RICO being the O, organizations, right? The problem that I see at the state level, and so I will say that I think that there is a space for RICO, keeping with the original intent of the statute to target organizations and people who don't give the order, who don't execute the crime, but who benefit from it and who create an environment in which those crimes have to occur in order for the organization to maintain its own existence, right? So I think the way the feds do it is really the right way to do it. I think the problem is that here in Georgia, you have prosecutors. I think RICO has become sexy. It's like the thing to do now, and ooh, it's RICO. And frankly, those of you who practice civil law, those of you plaintiff's attorneys, y'all are just as guilty. If we can find a way to RICO this case, that's what we're gonna do, because that's sexy. And I think that is dangerous, because if you are not targeting the organizational structure, if you can't articulate what RICO gets you, that conspiracy or aiding and abetting or your traditional tools of law enforcement don't get you, then I think the odds are good you're abusing the statute and taking it to its outer limits. And so when you are targeting a traditional organization, when you're going after the money and the way that it protects itself through the propagation of criminal racketeering activity that we would all agree is actually criminal, then that can be a good thing. And it's a powerful tool because it allows you to get people you otherwise can't get. And it allows you to punish them in a way that you otherwise might not be able to punish them. But I think the danger comes when you've got a statute written as broadly as ours, where you can take just a bunch of people getting together to engage in lawful activity, one of them goes rogue, and now everyone is potentially going to prison for 20 years. And so there's a balance there, and I will say this, like, the rule of law matters. We have to, I believe, I'm not an abolitionist. I know a lot of criminal defense attorneys are. I tell you, I'm moving in that direction really quickly, but I'm not there yet. I think the rule of law matters, but it's only as good as the prosecutors and the judges who uphold it. And so if you have prosecutors who do not have a good compass in the exercise of their discretion and who abuse power and exceed that limit, then I think that's a real threat. I think it's a threat to our entire criminal justice system. I think it's a threat to the integrity of the cases where it's properly brought, and for good reasons.
But just to add to that, I mean, there are very specific tactical advantages that RICO prosecutions afford prosecutors. They are able to prosecute pretty much in any venue in which they think an act occurred. So this, the Cox City indictment allows the Attorney General to prosecute in Fulton County. In every piece of potential evidence becomes relevant, and so, you know, police access to search warrants, right, is limitedly unchecked because you have to prove association, so you get people's phones and their computers and their diaries in order to gather evidence of communication to try and prove your conspiracy. Double jeopardy doesn't apply in the same way. RICO is not a lesser included offense to other charges, so there are these very specific advantages if the goal is aggressive prosecution that racketeering brings, in addition to the impact that it has on an individual defendant's ability to get an attorney and defend themselves, because these are just very, very, very capacious theories of liability that are tough to defend against.
I think there was also just kind of a part of your question that probably was overlooked a bit about the perception of crime being kind of on the rise. I forget how you worded it, but essentially, do prosecutors not need to be responsible to this perception that crime is on the rise? Which perception is a great word to use for that, because the reality has been that for decades at this point in time, I think it may be about 25 years, up until COVID hit, that crime, generally violent crime specifically, has been trending down nationally. And there was a spike during COVID. there were people who had lost jobs and without resources and means, and not to make excuses for anything, but it was not unpredictable that when people have less, that crime tends to go up. And there was this blip that began in 2020, and it kind of peaked in 2021, and then the same trend that we had seen over the previous decades begins to kind of show once again, right? And so to the extent is it needed or necessary for prosecutors to be responsive to what I would call inaccurate or false perceptions, I would say no. Because, and certainly not through the use of RICO, because to the extent that a crime has been committed, there are statutes that exist to prosecute persons for that, regardless of whether you're abolitionist or not. We know there are certain laws that exist for harming people or damaging property. I also think that, particularly in the Cobb City case, it's been a direct responsive to the defund argument and movement that kind of also gained popularity in 2020. Particularly in Atlanta, the story has been, oh my God, like crime is crazy. We don't have enough police, and the police don't have enough money, and they don't have enough training. But when you look at resources such as the police scorecard or mapping police violence, what you learn is that Atlanta has one of the most well-funded, well-resourced, best-trained police departments in the United States of America. We have more officers than 89% of departments in the United States. And this is a comparison study of over 14,000 different law enforcement agencies. There is more funding for police per capita for individuals in Atlanta than 71% of police departments. And the response of how these resources are given is that the Atlanta Police Department effectuates an arrest for low-level nonviolent offenses more frequently than 85% of departments in the United States of America. So we see all of these resources. Additionally, if you go to the, Atlanta has a dashboard, a public-facing dashboard that provides information about their training. And City of Atlanta receives more training than 90% of officers in Atlanta, more training than 70% of departments in the United States of America. So training is not an issue. So what we see is that they've used these abundant resources and staffing and training to effectuate arrests on low-level offenses and not towards violent crime or anything like that. And to get further into the weeds, because I also do policing violence work, there are racial disparities that are ridiculous in both arrest rates and use of force. In 2022, 100% of persons killed by unarmed persons killed by Atlanta Police Department were black. 88% of people, period, killed by Atlanta Police Department were black. There are more racial disparities in policing in the city of Atlanta than 83% of police departments in the United States of America. Black persons are 14.6 times more likely to be arrested for the same low-level offenses as white persons in Atlanta. Latinx folks are 3.5 times more likely to be arrested for the same level of offenses, right? And so when we have systems of oppression that seek to criminalize sections of community, then I just think we just have to reject the premise of those kind of perceptions. And the devil don't need an advocate.
On that note, I think we'll leave it there. I was given the blessing for an additional 5 minutes, so thanks everyone for sticking with us. Let's give our panelists a round of applause.
Terrific, terrific panel. Thank you so much. We're being delayed a hair by heavy traffic. We're waiting for a judge to make it into the room. So we're going to slide everything by about 10 minutes. So at 40 minutes before, after the hour, we'll start the next session. So 40 minutes after the hour, 15 minutes from now.
Right here, in front of our, yeah, so nice to meet you.
I so appreciate it.
Yes. Photo op. There you go. Big smiles, everybody. One more. And one more. There we go.
Rico. That's what the title should have been. Everyone's like Rico.
Thank you very much for coming.
This was a delightful day. I'm happy
for that. Oh, anytime. You're doing this. You are in.
Thank you for that, because in the past I've always been.
Well, but it saves us and it makes a permanent record.
You have to heckle for that.
Yes.